Testament, we read of the miracle Jesus performed in Nain, raising a widow's son from the dead. As we study this story's historical context, we'll discover she had stood to lose far more than just her beloved son. She would lose her financial security, her property and inheritance, and even her legacy and name. Christ's miracle of restoring the son also restored her. Like the widow of Nain, through the atonement of Jesus Christ, we too can be restored to all that the Father has promised us. The story begins just following the miracle of the Savior healing a centurion's servant while at Capernaum. Nain is located about 20 miles south of Capernaum and well off the main road. The village was just a small farming community with probably no more than a few hundred people. As Jesus arrives with a large group, he sees the procession of mourners carrying the dead body of a widow's only son. According to Jewish custom, if someone died, the body was to be prepared and buried on the same day. The fact that this woman had already lost her husband, and now her only son, would have significant implications on her future life. Bearing many children today is often almost seen as a...
Shalom, Malachim, peace be on you. Yohonathan Dao, we with you here, humbly so, Yahweh for Christians on WFUR 1590. Sean, the engineer, the man, I appreciate you, man. This is what they call the 19th of March, 2023, the year of their Lord. Today's topic, the widow of Nain. The widow of Nain. You just heard an intro about this story, the widow of Nain. Now, remember, this whole series is the Bamileotah series in his own words. And now we are in, well into now, the second year of his ministry. And last week we're talking about the centurion servant, the first miracle he does after the Sermon on the Mountain. Okay, remember this, Moshe 2.0 is go out and he heals what we would call a Gentile, someone that we wouldn't spend our time with, a centurion. In the Beatitudes, we teaching here that the Beatitudes really is an adjustment of our attitude. And the adjustment of our attitude reverses the curses of Deuteronomy. The curses that we hear about, all those curses, and also in Leviticus 26, Deuteronomy 28 and Leviticus 26, the adjustment of our attitude reverses those curses. We talked about last week how this is what the record says, that the people at the base of this mountain hearing this sermon from Yahushua were astonished, panicked, and in amazement. What? When was the last time you heard a sermon that astonished you and put you in a panic? When was the last time you heard a sermon that you were just totally jaw-dropped in amazement over? Yet, we read these Beatitudes thinking we already know it, and we read it with numbed minds, numbed ruach, numbed spirit, because we think we already know it. We think we already got it, and we just breezed through it, and I resonated how powerful and impacting this sermon was. This is his coming out, because in the first year, he was on a down low with the ministry. He didn't want it out there like that. Now we're here, and what he's teaching here is the Torah access to Yahweh gives us a shattered understanding from the temple to Yahushua. I gave you a soundbite from Chad Bird of 1517 Ministry. Gave a soundbite, and the soundbite is entitled Jesus and the Samaritan Woman at the Well. Chad Bird, 1517 Ministry. And what he says is that this sermon shows that's the word he used, of our understanding of access to Yahweh. The temple access is shattered. And that's what I'm teaching here. Sean, go ahead and cue up number two. We're going to go to John 1:29 that you may have missed. John 1:29.
That we may give an answer to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?
I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness. Make straight the way of the Lord, as the prophet Isaiah said.
Now those who were sent were from the Pharisees.
Why then do you baptize if you are not the Christ, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?
I'm baptized with water,
But there stands one among you whom you do not know. It is he who, coming after me, is preferred before me, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to loose.
These things were done in Bethabara, beyond the Jordan, where John was baptizing. The next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him.
Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, after me comes a man who is preferred before me, for he was before me. I did not know him, but that he should...
Wow, did you get that? That last verse, the verse before last, he said he takes away the sins of the world. Now, if you go to the only book in the Bible that actually tells you straight up is written to Hebrews, is to you, all right? And if you go to Hebrews 10:4, and it tells us that the temple way of sacrificing, the blood and stone, could not, says it was not possible to take away our sins. Hebrews 10:4, that way of access to Yahweh through the temple rites was not possible to take away our sins. Yet here, Yahushua's cousin, John the Baptist, as we call him, says he comes to take away our sins. Did you get that? Take away our sins. So this is why those who get it are shocked and amazed. The word says panicked. What? This man is taking away sins, whereas prior to him, the blood and stone sacrifices was not possible to take away our sins. What they did was cover our sins. Now here we got a brother up coming down here saying he's taking them away. This is earth-shattering. Now here we are in 2023, March the 19th of the year of their Lord, not getting it, not understanding it. New brews waking up and not really getting. You really should be like in shock and all. You said, wow, you're right. This is a whole new approach to our understanding of the Torah. This is something brand new. And why is it important? I alluded to it last week, or I gave you some homework last week, three scriptures, because this is going to have to be a topic all on by itself. I did it, really, I'm going to do it again, Isaiah 25:7. Why is this important for you to understand? I keep going over this over again. Isaiah 25:7, and he will destroy on this mountain the surface of the covering cast over all people, and the veil that is spread over all nations. That's deep. The veil that is spread over nations. When Yahushua said, Zay Nigmal, it is finished, what happened? The veil in the temple was rent in half, wasn't it? Open. That means you had straight access to see what only the most high priest could see. Now here you are, just regular Joe Blow on the street, got a right now to see exactly what only the high priest could see once a year. What is that Yeshayah talking about right here? At the end of the world, this veil. Revelation 12:9. I gave you this homework last week. Revelation 12:9. It reads, so that the great dragon was cast out, that serpent of old, called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. So we got two scriptures, one Old Testament, one New Testament, as you call it, deceiving the whole world. And the third scripture I gave you, chapter 20, verses 7 through 9, of Revelation, verse 20, verse 7 through 9, chapter 20, verse 7 through 9. Now, when the 1,000 years have expired, Satan will be released from his prison and will go out to deceive the nations which are on the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, whose number is as the sands of the sea. They went up from the breadth of the earth and surrounded the camp of the saints of the beloved city. And fire came down from Yahweh and of heaven and devoured them. So, take those three scriptures I gave you, and this series we're talking about, this new understanding of the Torah, and see how those three scriptures fit in. I'm going to go to it again. And this is why Yahushua says in Luke 18:8, why when he returns, he's going to find no faith on the earth. Because everyone is deceived. And what are they deceived by? Why is everyone deceived? Why is he going to find no faith on the earth? Well, let's give you an answer here, Isaiah 26 and 18. Let's go back to Yeshaya. 26 and 18. We have been with child. We have been in pain. We have, as it were, brought forth wind. We have not accomplished any deliverance in the earth, nor have the inhabitants of the world fallen. Yeshaya is saying right here, with all this naming and claiming, blabbing and grabbing, we the chosen ones, we the black Hebrew Israelites, we the people of the book, it's all about us. The sun rises and falls on our buttocks. With all of that, you waking up and hating the white man, hating the Jew man, with all that, all your ministries that you pray and cry and fast over thinking you're changing the world, with all that, Yeshaya says, not me, that all we did was deliver a fart. There is, he said, you have just delivered wind. That's all we did. With all that, this is why, and it says we have not accomplished any deliverance. That's not my words. The habits of the world have not fallen. The man still has his foot on your neck with all your knowledge and wisdom that you're sharing on social media. You ain't delivered nothing. Still on the back of the bus because you're not understanding what Yahushua gave to us in the Beatitudes, how your attitude ought to be. Let's juxtapose what we delivered. Can you imagine a woman going to deliver a baby? She's in the hospital, laying on there, ready to deliver a baby, and nothing comes out but wind, but gas. That's what he just said we did. He compares us to a woman, getting ready to deliver a baby, ain't nothing come out. That's his words. Now let's see, juxtapose that with Yahushua, with Yahweh. What did he deliver with all his work? Yeshaya 66 verses 1 through 11. Thus saith Yahweh, heaven is my throne and earth is my footstool. Where is the house that you will build for me? And where is the place of my rest? Because all those things my hands has made and all those things exist, says Yahweh. But on this one will I look, on him who is poor and of a contrite spirit and who trembles at my word. He who kills a bull is as if he who slays a man. See? He who tries to have access through him by killing a bull to have your sins forgiven, Yahweh says, it's just like you killed a man. Because it's murder. Because you're wasting your time. That's what he's saying. Not me. He who sacrifices a lamb as if he breaks a dog's neck. You might as well go ahead and break a dog's neck and offer that to Yahweh. Because that's how profane your righteousness is to him. He who offers a grain offering as if he offers swine's blood. You who don't believe in eating poke sandwiches and shrimps no more. You know what? He says, just go and offer me swine's blood with your righteousness. He who burns incense as if he who blesses an idol. Go ahead and worship idols. Go ahead and worship them. Just as they have chosen their own ways. And their soul delights in their abominations. Yahweh says, this is your own ways. He said, but this is Isaiah. This is the Old Testament. This is how you told us to worship you. Well, here's the thing. It's your own way. Because your heart is wicked and you did not understand the deepness of it. In this ministry, I keep trying to connect to you the meanings I'm reading to you from the New Testament and connecting it to the Old Testament with the spiritual meaning of it. But you just want to keep on seeing the superficial, the surface, the covering. You still want to keep those 666 commandments no matter what the Torah says that you got in 39 years of your desert of disobedience. The narrative continues on in verse 4. So I will choose their delusions and bring their fears on them, because when I called, no one answered. When I spoke, they did not hear. But they did evil before my eyes and chose that which I do not delight. Yahweh says he's going to choose your delusions. So now you waking up thinking you know everything and you're still deluded. I just wanted to stop by here and tell you that. If you're not receiving this man, his son, the olive branch, Yahushua HaMashiach, and his way of access to Yahweh, which is through him, not the old way. The narrative continues with Yeshayah in verse 5. Hear the word of Yahweh, you who tremble at his word. Your brethren who hated you, who cast you out for my name's sake, said. Now remember, they feared the scribes and Pharisees and Sadducees because they didn't want to be cast out of the temple. If they followed Yahushua and professed him, they will be cast out of the temple. And here we are in the Old Testament saying, Yahweh says, you who tremble at my word and fear my name, don't worry about them being casting you out of the temple. He says, let Yahweh be glorified that we may see your joy, but they will be ashamed. See, they're casting you out and marginalizing you. They're the ones going to be ashamed. Yes, I have been cast out by some of my closest brothers by teaching this truth. The narrative goes on, verse 6. The sound of noise from the city, a voice from the temple, the voice of Yahweh who fully repays his enemies. Before she was in labor, she gave birth. Before her pain came, she delivered a male child. Who has heard such a thing? Who has seen such things? Will the earth be made to give birth in one day? Or will a nation be born at once? For as soon as Zion was in labor, she gave birth to her children. Yahweh says, yeah, y'all delivered a fart, but I'm going to deliver a whole nation in one day. Is that not what happened in Pesach, which is coming up soon? April the 4th, 6:12 p.m. We came out of Mizraim. A nation was born in one day. Before the pain started, he said. Before even the... Can you imagine a woman getting laying on the table? Before her pain starts, boom, the baby's out there. Blah, ow, right there. Bam! That's what Yahweh does. What do we deliver? Verse 9. Will I bring to the time of birth and not cause the delivery? Yahweh said, am I going to go ahead and put up... I mean, and go ahead and write rubber checks? No, Yahweh says, when I speak, it's going to happen. Would I put up and not deliver, says Yahweh? Will I cause delivery to shut up the wound, says your mighty one? He says, rejoice with Jerusalem and be glad with her, all you who love her. Rejoice with joy with her, all you who mourn for her, that you may feed and be satisfied with the consolation of her bosom, that you may drink deeply and be delighted with the abundance of her glory. So those of you who bless us will be blessed. Those of you who curse us will curse. Pray for the shalom of Yisrael. Pray for the shalom. You're going to get the blessings too. So, you see how Yahweh says that he delivers. We just run our mouth. That's all we do. Cue with the, no, wait a minute. Okay, hold on. So, now, you didn't get that. Let me go to Matthew, give a second witness to what Yochanan the Baptist said. Matthew 1. Matthew 1. And 19 through 21. And it reads, then Yusuf, her husband, being a just man and not wanting to make her a public example, was minded to put her away secretly. But while he thought about these things, look, a Malachim of Yahweh appeared to him in a dream, saying, Yusuf, son of Dawid, do not be afraid to take to you Miriam, your wife, because for that which is conceived in her is of Ruach HaKodesh. And she will bring forth a bane, a son. And you will call his name Yahushua. Because he will save his people from their sins. From their sins. He ain't going to cover up nothing. He's going to save you from them. He's going to wash you clean. Blood stains water clean. So I hope, did you get that? Yochanan, his cousin, said he takes away the sins. And then the angel himself, out of his mouth, says he takes away sins. Hebrews 10:4 says the covenant of blood was not possible. That's the word it uses. Could not possibly take away our sins. It was a temporary thing. When you run track, and I did relays, the one man don't run against four men. He hands the baton off to the next man. And then the next man hands off. And then that baton gets handed off four times. The covenant gets renewed. It's the same race. but different legs. And now Yahushua took it, and y'all still trying to run the old dog, run the old man. And it ain't working. It's not working. Go ahead and cue up number 3.
Now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem.
Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him.
When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born.
In Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet, but you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are not the least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel.
Then Herod, when he had secretly called the wise men, determined from them what time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem.
Go and search carefully for the young child. And when you have found him, bring back word to me, that I may come and worship him also.
When they heard the king, they departed. And behold, the star which they had seen in the east went before them, till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy. And when they had come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented gifts to him, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Then, being divinely warned in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed for their own country another way. Now when they had departed, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream.
Arise, take the young child and his mother, flee to Egypt, and stay there until I bring you word, for Herod will seek the young child to destroy him.
Wow, y'all hear that? These, Herod the Edomite, see who was leading, people don't realize this, those who were in charge of us were Edomites, appointed by Rome, Romans, by the Roman government. And their response to this new king who's going to come and change everything, which means they will be toppled, their reign will be toppled, was fear. It says, the record says that he was troubled. And then what did they seek to do? To destroy this child. Verse 13 says to destroy him. So fear and panic. And first of all, you notice how our brothers, the Ishmaelites, is the one that followed the star. Ain't no Hebrews was awoke. Just like many of us are not awoke now. They are troubled at this birth. And they want to destroy the child. Revelation 12:4 says the dragon stood before the woman to devour the child, to destroy the child. Go ahead and cue up number 4. This is just like the dragon who wanted to devour and destroy the child who's shattering the glass onion. Go ahead and cue it up.
With the moon under her feet and on her head a garland of 12 stars. Then being with child, she cried out in labor and in pain to give birth. And another sign appeared in heaven. Behold, a great fiery red dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 diadems on his heads. His tail drew a third of the stars of heaven and threw them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman who was ready to give birth to devour her child as soon as it was born. She bore a male child who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron, and her child was caught up to God and his throne. Then the woman...
Wow. So King Herod being filled with the Hasatan to destroy the child was just like this. Wanted to devour the child soon as it's born. Why? Because he is the one that's shattering the glass onion, that's shattering our old blood and stone understanding of access to Yahweh. Because 2 Ezra 6:9 says that the end of Esau's world is the beginning of Jacob's world. One man's world ends, the baton gets handed off to us. We got it now. Walk with a new attitude. Reverse the curse. Walk with the power and authority and the purpose that Yahweh gave you. You are no longer a slave to sin. The veil was rent. Jeremiah 3. Let me go to Jeremiah 3. Uh, 15 and 16. And it reads, "And I will give you shepherds according to my heart, who will feed you with the knowledge and understanding. Then it will come to pass, when you are multiplied and increase in the land in those days, says Yahweh, that they will say no more the Ark of the Covenant of Yahweh. It will not come to mind, nor will they remember it, nor will they visit it, nor will it be made any more." Wow. Can you, I humbly say, I hope you will consider me to be a shepherd from Yahweh in these last days. And so you can stop calling on the Ark of the Covenant as your justification for your righteousness. Because the Deuteronomy says that these laws will be your righteousness. Good luck getting into the kingdom, living eternally with your righteousness. Because that covenant only promised you long life, not eternal life. And right here in Jeremiah, it says, you will no longer say the Ark of the Covenant of Yahweh. That's not my words. I'm just reading it from here, from the book. Jeremiah 3, 15 and 16. Let's go to Mark 14, 24. Man, I'm giving you these scriptures. We haven't gotten to the widow of Nain yet, but we will. I'm paid up for the month. Don't worry. We don't get it done today. It'll get done. Mark 14, 24. And it reads, Yahushua speaking, and he said to them, "This is my dom, my blood, of the new covenant, which is shed for many. Assuredly I say to you, I will no longer drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of Yahweh." Yahushua's words, he said that his blood is the new covenant. The new covenant, it's a new thing. He is shattering our whole understanding. We got a new reality, a new world. Go ahead, my brother. Now we're going to go into this widow of Nain. Cue up number 5. The widow's son raised.
"The day after that he went into a city called Nain, and many of his disciples went with him, and a large crowd. And when he came near the gate of the city, behold, a dead man was being carried out, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow. And a large crowd from the city was with her. When the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her."
"Do not weep."
"Then he came and touched the open coffin, and those who carried him stood still."
"Young man, I say to you, arise."
"So he who was dead sat up and began to speak, and he presented him to his mother. Then fear came upon all, and they glorified God."
"A great prophet has risen up among us.
God has visited his people."
"And this report about him went throughout all Judea and all the surrounding."
Wow. First of all, I hope Og Joe is listening, because I really wish I had some sound bites with the Kodesh names being spoken. So I got what I got. And I bless Yahweh for my main man Chris here, who getting us, pulling these things up for me. We have an anointed voice in Yisrael. His name is Ak Joe, Joe Carter. And he has a voice that's beautiful. Because first of all, that Jesus they got sound like a wimp. "Fear not." He sound like a straight up somebody you just kick sand in their face on the beach. But that's what I got. hear the message. And it's a deep message. This is the widow of Nain. This is the second miracle he does right after the Sermon on the Mount. And this miracle is chock full of stuff. Oh, it's just beautiful. For those who love Yahushua and who wants to see the spiritual connection, want to see the deeper level of the lessons he's teaching here. Now, one of the things we notice right off the bat for those who are true students of this word is that this widow is not just losing a son. I mean, you lose a son today, it hurts. It's always hurt to lose a son since Abel was killed by his brother Cain. That's not the point. The point is, though, in this time, losing a son, man, you will end up, and your only son, and your husband's already dead, you're now homeless. It ain't no government checks coming, no welfare checks coming. You ain't got no food stamps coming, no government cheese going to bail you out. You're homeless in this system. In this system of the covenant, of that covenant. Now, if these leaders of the covenant were so Kodesh and righteous, would they not have the Jubilee being recognized where all debts are forgiven? That's part of the old covenant. But they didn't do that. And even here, you did have they had in place for this kind of situation where the brother would have to marry his brother's wife and rear up children for her. But she's already old. The son is already a man, so she's probably too old for that. So what we find here is that when this widow, she lost her financial security, her property, her inheritance, because the woman could not own the land. So she lost her inheritance. She even lost her legacy and her name. No one's going to remember her because everything goes down through the man. So this is a huge, huge deal here. This is a big deal. It's not just a heart-shattering, heartbreaking loss of a son. I just came from a funeral a month ago of a young woman who lost her son. It hurt. It hurt me to tears. And every day I see her, I still think about it. And she's now, you know, she has to go back to work now. But she's back at work and she's not homeless. She has a job. Where in this time, you didn't have no, your job, your son was out there, your husband, and your sons were out doing this work. And you prepared the food, you took care of the home. Now she's going to be homeless. Chris, go ahead and cue up number 6. We're going to see this miracle. Talk about this miracle.
Even greater similarity is yet to come. For Christ, the only begotten Son, whose mother is also likely a widow, will die and yet live again. Just as the widow's son's raising of the dead restored her inheritance, Jesus Christ's resurrection restores our inheritance. The Savior comes not just to the widows and the orphan.
Wow. You know what? That was not part of the original lineup. That just came up this morning because it touched me. Yahushua, see, this woman represents Yisrael. She represents us. The death of Yahushua means we lose everything. We lose our security. We lose our inheritance. We lose our legacy. We lose our name. But just like this widow's son, he was resurrected. And Yahushua is the resurrection and the life and the way. He is the first resurrection of the dead. So indeed, with his resurrection, today we do not have to weep. Today we do not have to cry. Today we actually have life in him, in his resurrection. And now we have hope because he resurrected. I didn't get that until this morning. I didn't get that till this morning. When her son arose, her life was renewed. We would be miserable in our sins if Yahushua didn't resurrect it after that third day. If the only begotten Son of Yahweh had not resurrected, we remember, we are the bride. We will be widows. We don't have a father. We don't have a son. We have nada. We have nothing. It was touching to me that I had to add that in there this morning. And if you didn't get it, this miracle happens a few miles away from the Old Testament. Remember, everything that's happening here in the so-called New Testament, they had no New Testament. The whole so-called Bible was the Old Testament. Where is the connection to this for their Torah? Elisha. Elisha's resurrection of the widow's of the woman's son. Remember, he laid on that boy's body and brought him back to life. Brought him back to life. This happened a few miles from the town of Nain. So those there already knew their history of their area, and they like, wow, this is a great prophet. Now they didn't get the total clue. They made the connection between this miracle and the miracle that happened 800 years prior with Elisha. 800 years prior, based on their history. When you go to Nain, you can get their, you Google their history. They had that on there in their brochure and their tours. Hey, this is where the miracle would have, you know, only three times in the Old Testament where anybody raised from the dead. So it's a rare thing. So this was on their brochure if you came through that town. And now they got this one. And they called him a great prophet. Why? Because Elisha was a great prophet. So they didn't quite get it. They did make the connection of the miracle of how life, we could be reborn again and have life again. But this man who did this was more than a prophet. This man was the Son of Yahweh. This man was the very Son of the living Yah, the living Elohim. Remember, he was challenged by the Sadducees about the resurrection, who didn't believe in the resurrection. This right here shows that he is indeed the resurrection and the life. Let me break down this verse by verse. Okay? In verse 11, it reads, we already heard it read, I know, but I'm going to read it. Now it happened the day after. This is the day after now that he already raised the centurion's son, servant. Okay, so you got a Roman, a hated Roman, whose servant, who was Hebrew, was healed. So this is the day after. That happened the day after that. He went into a city called Nain. Okay, so they walked. That's a long little walk. And many of his disciples went with him and a large crowd. I keep thinking about this. So he's walking this journey of, I forget how many miles it is. It's a number of miles, about 10 miles or so, or less, a little bit less. And he's got this crowd. The only thing I could think of was Michael Jackson in his heyday. He could not get anywhere alone, be by himself, and have a break. Everybody following behind him, following him wherever he went. And Michael means like L. So Yahushua now, who's in the height of his popularity, He's out and about, and he's going from point A to point B, and large crowds are following him. And he has scores of disciples at this time. Not just the 12 that he selected. He has scores of disciples. So it says a large crowd followed him, and all that walk. Now in verse 12, it goes on to read, and when he came near the gate of the city, look, and by the way, this city is off the beaten path. It's a very small city of only a few hundred people. So it's a very small town. It's not a city, it's a town. Off the beaten path, and these people followed him. And when he came near to the gate of the city, behold, a dead man was being carried out, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow. And a large crowd from the city was with her. Now, you got a large crowd following Yahushua going in. A large crowd following this dead man going out. So you got two crowds coming together. One following, what is this brother going to do next? Another one in mourning. I think about that like a video. Two crowds coming to meet each other. What are they going to do? You going to dance? You going to fight? What are you going to do? verse 13. And it reads, When the master saw her, he had compassion on her and said to her, Al Abal, do not weep. Yahushua had compassion on her. He knows that this woman not just lost a son, she lost her identity. She lost her life, her living. She lost everything. And she had represented us. Yahushua had a heart for her because he loved her. He loved us. He knows that without him, we can do nothing. He knows that without him, we are lost. We have lost our inheritance. We have nothing. We are sifted as wheat. We are stomped down like dust. We have no life in us without him. And for those who were keen to this, they got the message. Those who were in shock and awe and amazement and astonished at his word, who were in a panic of, wow, what do we do now? The way I woke up yesterday is different than how I wake up today in terms of my understanding. My whole world is different. Life is different with this man. Where is he going next? What is he going to do now? And what he's going to do now is raise up Yisrael. He's going to raise up Yisrael and give us a new life. So he tells her, Al Abal. Then in verse, continuing on in reading. So do not weep, Al Abal. Then he came and touched the open coffin. And those who carried him stood still. So look at this. That makes you unclean. See, Hebrews, they know you don't touch that because you're unclean. Those who carried the coffin were going to be unclean for 7 days. They had to be outside the town and go through a ritual. But remember that we are teaching here that Yahushua is the ruddy heifer. The ruddy heifer makes all things clean. This is another sign that this man is not just a prophet. He's not just a good man. He is indeed the Son of Yahweh. And one of the slices of his attributes is that of healing as the ruddy heifer did. Now, Yisrael, under Roman rule, and under all the subsequent rule we were under rule for a thousand years. So we had not had, remember, we had the Assyrian, we had Babylon, we had Persia, and then we had a whole lot of other subsequent rulings over us. Then we had Greece, and then we had Rome. So we had thousands of years where we had no ruddy heifer sacrifice. We find ourselves, this is why when Yahushua came, he was cast out so many demons and doing so much healings, because we did not have the clean living water that comes from the ruddy heifer. We did not have that anymore. One of the signs that Yahushua was who he say he was that he healed people. He touched the unclean. He touched the unclean. So he made a point of touching this dead man and touching the coffin. Let them know that I'm not just a prophet. So it's, the record says that he touched the coffin. And those who carried him stood still. Then he says, young man, I say to you, kum. That is, arise. Kum. Arise. Oh, what a great thing to hear. Can you imagine that you're in the pit of blackness, in the pit of hell, in darkness, and then your ears hear the living sound, kum, arise. So he who was dead sat up and began to speak. And he presented him to his mother. Yahushua presented him to his mother. Oh man, I picked myself up, put myself in that spot. That's so touching. Yahushua is so touching. He is so endearing. Remember, we talked about how it was a very intimate conversation he was having with that woman at the well. That was an intimate interaction there. That was not just back and forth conversation. That was a woman receiving him as a Gentile bride. That whole narrative was an intimate narrative. Yahweh sure was always intimate with the women in a Sadiq way. In a Sadiq way. You're going to hear, actually, probably even next week, we got the one where the sinful woman anoints him. This prostitute woman anoints him. We might be doing that next week. So stay tuned. But we see how the women are the ones who were endearing to him, because they're the ones who were marginalized by the men. They're the ones who are put back. The narrative says a new thing is going to happen on this earth. The woman is going to encompass the man. The first messenger of the Besorah, which you call gospel, was the Samaritan woman. She was the first one to proclaim the Tob news of this new access to Yahweh was a Samaritan woman. She says, go, come, see a man who told me everything about myself. Yahshua came back, everybody was there. All the men followed, and everybody was there to see, to hear what this man had to say. So we got here, he says, Kum. He tells her to arise, the man to rise. And he lifted him up and presented him to the widow. That is so, that's a blessing, that's a blessing. And then the record says, in verse 15, so he who was dead sat up and began to speak. And he presented him to his mother. He testifies. He rises up and he speaks and he testifies of what happened to him. No one else had an experience of being dead and then alive. He had a unique testimony to give. You know, every week, Pastor Mike has us give a testimony. And we say something about, just to give a testimony, a word of encouragement. How many people got a testimony saying, hey, I was dead, now I live? That's a testimony. That's a testimony of all testimonies. That you were on the other side of the dirt, and now you are living. Now you arise. The man said, boom, rise, live. Verse 16 and 17, it says, then fear came upon all of them, and they glorified Yahweh, saying, a great prophet has risen among us, and Yahweh has visited his people, and this report about him went throughout all Judea and all surrounding region. Now, boy, he was all over social media then. They didn't still quite get it. They called him just a prophet, but they would get it. Let me go to the New Testament commentary on the Old Testament. Okay. Page 299. Remember, they had no New Testament. Everything that was going on here gives, it points to the Old Testament if you get it. Let's see what their commentary is on this whole narrative. It says that we may recall how Elijah raising the widow's son in 1 Kings 17:17-24 was already noted. But the list of parallels to these two miracles. A widow is the main character in the Old Testament narrative and the New Testament. The widow is the main character. Then the widow has a death of her son. And then the meeting of the widow is at the gate of the city. See how the parallels go? And then we have that the clause, Edokin Atun Te Metri Oton. He gave him to his mother. So Elijah presented the son to his mother, and Yahushua presented the son to his mother. See all the parallels? And it says, moreover, the acclamation, a great prophet has arisen among us, resembles the Targumatic reading of 1 Kings 17:24. You are a prophet of Yahweh. Of a similar account of the raising of a woman's son is found in 2 Kings 4:32-37. So here this book is making all the connection to the Old Testament. It says where Elisha carries on the ministry of his predecessor. It's also important to note how this narrative surpasses the Elijah account in that Jesus is able to speak directly to the dead son and resuscitate him. Thus, Jesus is to be viewed as Holkarios, the Lord, it says, not merely as a prophet of old, So this is what I'm saying. See, Elisha had to lay on the body. And Elijah, they had to use other means to raise the son. But Yahushua merely spoke. How was everything created? By the power of his word. Yahweh is the life giver, and Yahweh is the life sustainer, and Yahweh is the life rejuvenator. He does these things. He is not just a good man. Remember the rich young ruler? No, it was the lawyer. Greeted Yahushua and says, "Good man." Yahushua stopped him. "Why are you calling me good? There's nobody good but Yahweh." So what he was saying is, either I'm who I say I am, either I'm Yahweh, his son, or I'm not. I ain't just no good man. You're not going to put me down on the level of a man like you. I am the son of man. I am the son of the original man, Yahweh's son, Yahweh's bane. I am the one who shatters the glass onion. I make all things new. Your old way of accessing to Yahweh is done. You're not out here buying a flat screen TV and trying to hook a Betamax up to it to watch Starsky and Hutch or Shaft or whatever. You're not out here with your brand new 2024 Corvette getting an 8-track trying to listen to Al Green. Is not going to work. Again, I direct you to Isaiah, Yeshayah 25:7, Revelations 12:9, Revelation 27-9. Read those three scriptures. That's just a foundation I'm going to be going through when I go back into that lesson again about what's going to deceive the whole world. What's going to fool the entire world? I hope you're getting the clue of what you got in your 39 years in the desert of disobedience. We must accept he who is the way, the truth, and the light. No man comes to the Father but by him. Remember, when he cast out the demons, talk about the cast out the demons in Matthew 12. That's a good thing. All the demons are cast out. The man's house was clean. That's a good thing. You got a clean house. But what happened was he didn't replace it with Yahushua. Remember in Revelations 12, he says, "Look, I stand at the door and I knock. He who is waiting on me and opens the door and lets me in, I sup with him and he with me." If we're going to clean our house, we must then replace it with the man who is the life, who is the truth. Hallelujah. 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 Way. Go ahead and cue up number 7. I'm still going to have some time left, though, but that's fine.
Master compassionately restored the widow's financial security, inheritance, and her name and legacy.
So if
because
I had time,
of our sins,
if I had time,
we each have
on higher grounds
in the kingdom of God. In our fallen state, we too have a need of restoration, a redemption from our sins. Thankfully, just as the Savior was able to restore all that the widow had lost, the Savior can restore us
right after
to our rightful
we'll
places.
Let me come back in. Let me come back in.
Because I got time,
just
right?
Just as he did for the widow, Jesus is eager to come to us in our moment of greatest despair, not because we are deserving, but because of his great love for us. All that is asked of us is to accept him, repent, and strive to follow his example.
Wow. I'm telling you, I really... the best voice I hear is my brother Joe. Joe, we can get... I believe one day we can get a whole Bible narrated. We can have someone using the Kodesh names and have it... dramatized though, with the sounds and the action behind it, and have it, not just reading it. And I'm trying my best to give us a better presentation here. I'm trying my best to just I'm up in the ante here on Yahweh for Christians with this broadcast, hoping you're enjoying these new things I'm doing here. You know, I couldn't do it without my main man Chris, the engineer supreme. But he does make me sound better, add some professionalism to this ministry. I bless Yahweh for him. And so just give me some feedback on whether you like this. Now, I need you to subscribe to the YouTube channel. I got a whole 4 times the amount of people, at least, who are following on the radio based on the feedback I'm getting, but it's not transferring to the channel. So subscribe to it, support, and like, and get those numbers up. I also, again, Peshach is coming up, so if we're not going to finish this whole series, we are going to take a break. We do Peshach is on April the 4th at 6:12 p.m. That's when I have it. Unleavened Bread is on 4:06. Last Shabbat is 4:13. Yahushua Ministries is who I follow, Pastor Williams. The number is 516-253-3286, 516-253-3286. On Shabbat evening, Friday around 7 o'clock, well, at 7 o'clock when you have the Bible studies, and it goes from 7 to about 9 o'clock, 9:30. Then on Shabbat day's time at 11, we have another Bible lesson. And on both of these days, you can speak. He asks questions. You can answer them. You give your points, your opinions, or your scriptures, or whatever. It's a back and forth. It's an interactive. But then at 2 o'clock, or around 2:30, then he gives the sermon. And that is recorded. You can go to Yahushua Ministries and get years and years of old sermons to get an understanding on that. And then I want you to keep it locked where you got it. From my main man, Pastor Ron Davis, who will be on in about 30 minutes. Next week, we might be talking about that woman who anoints Yahushua's feet. Until then, Yonatan Dawivi here. Shalom Aleichem. Peace be on you. Pray for the shalom of Yisrael. Keep